Yeah, so last time we finished on discussing the relation between the structure of derived categories of various Fano trifolds, and I just reproduced on this blackboard the table that we had yesterday. So let me just remind that, so this is for everything for Fano trifolds of index one, of Picard number one, and in this case, you can classify such varieties first according to the value of their index, of the divisibility of their canonical class, then for the two maximal possible values of the index, we have only two Fano varieties, and probably I should also say that for both of them, there is a full exceptional collection. And so the interesting part is the index two and the index one case. So in index two, we have just five varieties classified by their half anticanonical degree, just the degree of the one half of the anticanonical divisor, which takes all values from one to five. And we denote the corresponding threefold by YD. And for index one, the corresponding varieties are classified by their genus, which is defined in a way that 2g minus 2 is the anticanonical degree of the threefold. And the possible values for this genus, so the genus is bounded from above by 12, from below by 2, and genus is not equal to 11. So the possible values are on the blackboard. And then we mentioned this funny observation that at least for D greater or equal than 3, if you consider the non-trivial component of the derived category of the Fano threefold of index 2 and degree D, and the non-trivial component of the Fano threefold of index 1 and genus 2d plus 2, then the non-trivial components are equivalent if you choose the Fano threefolds in their moduli spaces appropriately. In fact, there is a correspondence in the product of two moduli spaces which maps surjectively onto both factors, and for which if you take a pair of Fano threefolds corresponding to a point of this correspondence, then these categories are equivalent. Okay, so this is a theorem, and of course it is a, so in some sense this theorem gives like identifications of non-trivial pieces of categories for these pairs of Fano threefolds, and of course one can also ask what happens for d equal 2 and d equal 1. Is something similar holds. And in fact, it seems to be, this is not a theorem, but most probably this is what one should expect. So this is an expectation that for D equal 2, in some sense, the categories of type B and the categories of type A should correspond to the points of a common family of categories. So there should be a family, in some sense, a flat family of triangulated categories such that both B Y2 and A X6 are members of this family. So in some sense, they are one category is a deformation of the other category. This is just the other way to express this relation. In particular, these categories for threefolds Y2 and for threefolds X6, they have the same invariants. So if you consider, for instance, Hochschild homology, then they are isomorphic. Or you can consider the Grothendieck group, and you can equip it with the Euler bilinear form, then the corresponding lattices will be isomorphic, and so on. So, but so far it is not quite clear how such a family of triangulated categories, which will include both categories of this type and that type, how this can be constructed. And another interesting question, whether these two subfamilies of this family have some intersection points. Are there some threefolds of this type? And can one find a pair of a threefold of this type and a threefold of that type such that the corresponding categories are equivalent? This is not quite clear, but this is maybe not too complicated question, so maybe with time this will become clear. And what one should expect for d equal to 1, so here the situation is probably even more complicated. In fact, it looks like the category of type A, so the category associated with a threefold of index 1, AX4, should be a degeneration of the category of type X1 of BX1. So in particular, if you compare some invariants of the corresponding finite threefolds, I mean, a reasonable thing to compare is the intermediate Jacobians. So for instance, if you compute the dimension of the intermediate Jacobian, so here it is Y1, sorry. If you compute the intermediate Jacobian of this threefold, it has dimension 21, and the intermediate Jacobian of this threefold has dimension 20. So it looks like indeed a simple degeneration. One is on a categorical level, is a degeneration of the other. So in some sense, there is some expectation on what should be true for these varieties. So of course, one can also ask what happens for the other finite threefolds of index 1. And here the situation is quite well understood for the two biggest values of the genus, for genus 9 and genus 7. And it is much less clear for small values of genus. So let me first say what happens for genus 9 and genus 7. So if you take any finite threefold of genus 9, then its derived category has a semi-orthogonal decomposition in which, again, there are two exceptional objects. One is the structure sheaf, and the other is a certain vector bundle of rank 3. And the remaining component, in fact, is equivalent to the derived category of a curve of genus 3. So C3, the curve of genus 3. And a similar decomposition exists for the threefold of genus 7. So in this case, again, there is a pair of exceptional vector bundles. One is the structure sheaf, and another one is a vector bundle of rank 5. And the remaining piece is the derived category of a curve of genus 7. So this is how it looks in this case. So these two cases are also understood. But the remaining three cases are much less understood. For instance, I don't know whether there is, I mean, of course, the structure sheaf is an exceptional object in all these cases, but it is not clear whether it can be extended to an exceptional pair. So it would be nice to construct a second exceptional object in the derived category of these threefolds, and then to understand the orthogonal subcategory. In fact, one can say something about genus 5 case. One can give another interpretation for the orthogonal to the structure shift in terms of a certain shift of algebras on a projective plane, but so far it doesn't help much. So this is what we know about the structure of these derived categories. Now, of course, the next question to discuss is what kind of geometrical consequences these structural results have. So what are geometric implications? Mm-hmm. Yes, 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 yeah. So you recovered the... this is one of the ways to recover it, yeah, indeed. Another way is that you can consider, you can choose a particular moduli space of vector bundles on the corresponding threefold, and this moduli space will be this curve, and then the universal object for this moduli space will give you a functor from one derived category to the other, which gives you this embedding. I mean, from the point of view of intermediate Jacobians, it is quite hard to construct a functor, a reasonable functor. But interpreting this in that way, you can do it. And in fact, this is typically what you should expect in general. If you expect that derived category of one variety contains the derived category of another variety as the same orthogonal component, then you should have the embedding functor. And there is a very nice Arlov's result that says that such an embedding functor is always a Fourier-Mukai kernel. So this Fourier-Mukai kernel should give you, is an object on the product of these two varieties. And you can think about it as about a family of objects on one variety parameterized by the other variety. So if you want to construct such a decomposition, you should look for a nice moduli problem. But also, I mean, in some sense, my point that you can also work in the opposite direction. As soon as you know that there is some decomposition of this sort, then you can somehow consider any moduli space on this variety, on the big variety. And then if you take any object parameterized by this moduli problem, you can also project it to this subcategory. And then you will get, you can consider also the moduli space for these projections of the object. And the projection functor will give you a morphism between these moduli spaces. Of course, in general, it will be rational because, I mean, a priori for different objects, you can land into objects with different classes in the Grothendieck group. This is, of course, not true, but, I mean, some of them may be stable for your stability condition, some may be not. I mean, the map in general is rational, but let us pretend that it is regular. Then typically in this way, you will have a description of this moduli space in terms of that moduli space plus some additional data. And this is, in many cases, this can be observed. So for instance, in these three cases, in the cases of this equivalence, it is natural to expect some relation between moduli spaces on one threefold and on the other threefold. And maybe let me mention one of such relations. So maybe theorem. Okay, it doesn't. So assume that d is greater or equal than 3, and x sub d and y sub d and x sub 2d plus 2 is a pair of threefolds such that the corresponding categories are equivalent. just a pair of trifolds corresponding to a point of this C that lives here. Then one can consider two moduli spaces. One moduli space is the Hilbert scheme of lines on YD. So this is a very natural variety associated to this Fanner threefold, just the Hilbert scheme of lines. And for the threefold of the other type, you can consider the Hilbert scheme of conics, 2D plus 2. And the statement is that they are just isomorphic for any such pair. So the variety that parameterizes lines on one variety also parameterizes conics on the other variety. And in fact, the way how it can be proved is just by observing that if you consider, this is not quite proof, but this is an explanation for this coincidence, is that if you take a line on YD, then its ideal is an object of this subcategory, in fact. In fact, it is very easy to see that the ideal of a line is semi-orthogonal both to the structure sheaf and to the line bundle O of 1. So it lives in this subcategory. And if you take a conic on X 2D plus 2, and again you take its ideal, then this ideal is in this subcategory, X 2D plus 2. And also you can check that the equivalence of this theorem just takes ideals of lines to ideals of conics. So it gives you this identification. So this isomorphism is induced by this equivalence. And of course, if you consider some more complicated moduli spaces associated with these two varieties, you probably, then you will have a picture of the sort that I just described. There will be a morphism, maybe a rational morphism from a moduli space corresponding to this variety to some moduli space of objects in the corresponding subcategory B, which will be identified with some moduli space of objects in the subcategory A, to which some moduli space of objects on X will be mapped. And so you will have a certain nice correspondence between these moduli spaces. And if you are lucky, in the best situation, you will have just an isomorphism of this type, but maybe you will have a morphism and a description of fibers for this morphism, or something of this sort. But you see that this geometric isomorphism is a very nice manifestation of this equivalence of categories. So you have some result on a categorical level, and then, of course, it gives you many results on a geometrical level. Okay, and maybe a good question in this direction, which gives a link to the lectures of Arendt, is, imagine that you have such a category, yeah? Then if you want to speak rigorously about moduli spaces of objects in this category, you need some stability condition on this category. So a question is whether these categories admit stability conditions. And as far as I know, it is a very, very, very recent result that the derived categories of these Fanner threefolds themselves have some stability conditions. This is a recent result by Emanuele Macri. So I think also Marcello Bernardara and I don't remember the other people. So maybe Paolo Stellari also who will come for the third week. So maybe we can ask him about the progress. And of course, it would be very natural also to try to construct some stability conditions for these categories, because this will make this relation between moduli spaces more rigorous. Okay, so this is what we have for these pairs. And of course, we expect something similar in these two cases. For instance, it is natural to expect that the Hilbert scheme of lines for the threefold of type Y2 is probably a deformation of the Hilbert scheme of conics for the variety X6. And a similar degeneration result for D equal 1. But this I cannot say whether this is true or not so far. Okay. Now, what about these two varieties, about genus 9 and genus 7 threefolds? Here we have this description of the derived categories in which this curve appear. And of course, it is natural to have some relation between moduli spaces of objects here and on the corresponding curves. And in fact, there is a series of papers by Daniele Faenzi and Maria Chiara Brambilla who discussed this question. So they construct some relation, very explicit relation between moduli spaces of vector bundles on the threefolds XG and moduli spaces of vector bundles on the corresponding curves. Responding curves. And I mean, one of the particular cases of this result, which I remember, is that if you consider genus 7 case and if you consider the Hilbert scheme of conics on the corresponding Fana threefold, then it will be just isomorphic to the second symmetric power of this curve of genus 7. So in this case, this is just the surface which parameterizes pairs of points on the corresponding curve. So this is another way how the curve can be reconstructed. Okay. Faenzi, Brambilla Faenzi. Okay, so as I said, for smaller values of the genus, it is hard to say anything because we don't have a good description of the category. Okay, so this is what do we have for threefolds. Let me say some words about higher dimension. Of course, I mean, in general, what one can say in this direction is limited by our knowledge of the structure of semi-orthogonal decompositions. So in cases when we have some knowledge of this type, we can investigate these problems, we can find relation between moduli spaces and so on. So this is why I don't consider just arbitrary variety of some dimension, but restrict to some examples in which cases there is a good description. So a very interesting variety of dimension 4 for which some version of this story exists is a cubic fourfold. So let me say something about this case. So by definition, this is just a hypersurface of degree 3 in P5. Yeah, so degree of x is 3. And let us restrict to the smooth case. So a smooth hypersurface of degree 3 in P5. So how one can construct a semi-orthogonal decomposition for such a hypersurface? Of course, I mean, we can use the same idea. We can find some exceptional collection, and then consider this collection and its orthogonal subcategory. And since the canonical class in this case is just O of minus 3, so the Kudaira vanishing says that there is an exceptional collection of length 3. So O, O of 1, and O of 2, they form an exceptional collection. And as usual, you can extend it to a semi-orthogonal decomposition, and there will be a decomposition of this sort, d of x, with the four components, with these four components. Three components are very simple, generated just by line bundles, each of them equivalent to derived category of vector spaces, and one more component which, in which all the non-trivial information about the cubic is concentrated. So what one can say about this component? So in fact, it has very interesting properties. So first of all, one can consider its surfunctor. So surfunctor, I did not give you the definition, but this is the functor that encodes information about surduality. So maybe let me write the definition here. So if you have a nice triangulated category T, then one can define its surfunctor by requiring that there should be a bifunctorial isomorphism between homes from F1 to F2, dual, and homes from F2 to S sub T of F1. Yeah, so this is precisely what happens for the surduality when T is d of x. So in fact, such existence of such a functorial isomorphism determines this functor in a unique way. There is, if the surfunctor exists, then it is unique. And for T equal to d of x, S sub T is isomorphic to the tensor product with a canonical class and the shift by the dimension. So in particular, if we think about a triangulated category as about a non-commutative variety, then the information about its surfunctor encodes, in some sense, its canonical class and its dimension, both the first and the second. So what one can say about the surfunctor of this subcategory? In fact, what one can check is that this surfunctor is just isomorphic to the shift by 2. So in particular, if we think about the surfunctor as about tensoring with canonical class and shift by the dimension, then the canonical class should be trivial in this case, and the dimension should be 2. So if we think about this category as about a non-commutative variety, this variety should be a surface with a trivial canonical class. Yeah? And what kind of surfaces with this property do we know? Of course, in the usual commutative world, we know only two classes of surfaces of that type, basically K3 surfaces and abelian surfaces. And so the next question is how to distinguish between these two classes. So should we think about this category as about a non-commutative K3, or should we think about it as about a non-commutative abelian surface? And to distinguish between these two, one can consider the Hochschild homology of this category. And again, for a general triangulated category, one can define this Hochschild homology by considering the identity functor of this category, by considering surfunctor of this category, and by considering all X groups between these two functors. I mean, of course, this definition should be modified to make it rigorous. One should explain why and how one can consider X groups between functors and the functors of a triangulated category. It requires some work, but I probably don't have time for this. Just believe me that this Hochschild homology can be defined, that it is a nice invariant. In fact, maybe I should say that just two properties of this invariant. So the first property is that for categories corresponding to varieties, for derived categories of algebraic varieties, this gives you some well-known geometric invariants. So if T is D of X, then the Hochschild homology of T, so of D of X, in degree K, this is just the direct sum over all Q minus P equal K of H PQ of X. This is just the Hodge cohomologies of your variety. And this is called Hochschild constant Rosenberg isomorphism. There is a natural isomorphism of this type. And this is one important property of Hochschild homology. And the second important property is that Hochschild homology is additive with respect to semi-orthogonal decompositions. So if T has a semi-orthogonal decomposition with several components, then Hochschild homology of T is just the direct sum of the Hochschild homology of the components. So in particular, if you want to compute Hochschild homology of this particular category, this is very easy. So first you should compute the Hochschild homology of D of X, and for this you have to know the Hodge numbers, and the Hodge diamond in this case looks just like that. So, and all the other Hodge numbers are zero. So the Hochschild homology of D of X in this case. So by this formula, to get the dimensions, we should just sum along the columns of the Hodge diamond. So we will have 1 in degree minus 2. We will have 25 in degree 0 and 1 in degree 2. So this is just C in degree minus 2, C 25 in degree 0, and C in degree minus 2. In degree 2, yeah. So the formula will be like that. And then if by using this additivity property, we should just subtract from this the Hochschild homology of these three categories. And since each of these categories is equivalent to the derived category of vector spaces, by, again, for instance, by Hochschild constant Rosenberg, its Hochschild homology is just C, sitting in degree zero. So we should just quotient out by a three-dimensional vector space in degree zero. So the Hochschild homology of this category, the what we get as a result, it will be just C in degree minus 2, C 22 in degree zero, and C in degree 2. And clearly, you have the same answer for a K3 surface, yeah? The Hochschild, the Hodge diamond of a K3 surface looks like that, and it gives you precisely the same numbers for the dimensions of the Hochschild homology. And if you consider the Hodge diamond of an abelian surface, it will be completely different. You will have non-trivial HH1 and HH-1, for instance, and HH0 also will be different from that. So clearly from this point of view, AX should be thought of as a non-commutative K K3 surface. And in fact, there are, let me say a couple more things about this category as a kind of explanation why it is very reasonable to think about this category in this way. So first of all, in fact, for some cubic fourfolds, or some X, in fact, there is a K3, a commutative K3 surface. Why? Such that AX is equivalent to D of Y. So, for instance, one of the examples is the following. Let us take Grassmannian 2,6. So maybe let me take a vector space of dimension 6. And let us consider Grassmannian of two-dimensional subspaces in it. And so by definition, it lives in the, its Plucker embedding embeds it into the projectivization of the second wedge power of the space W. And let us take some subspace of codimension 6 in it. So let codimension of V W also be equal to 6. Let us consider this general linear subspace of codimension 6. Then we can define Y to be just the intersection of this Grassmannian with this linear subspace in this Plucker space. So in other words, this Y is just linear section of codimension 6 of this Grassmannian. Then, in fact, Y is a K3 surface. And this is very easy to see if you use a junction formula to compute the canonical class. And if you use Lefschetz theorem to control the cohomology, then you get this result for free. So this is a K3 surface. And now let us also see that it is naturally associated to a certain cubic fourfold. In fact, to do this, let us consider, so our space V was a subspace in lambda 2W. So we can consider the dual spaces, lambda 2W dual. There will be, this embedding will give you a surjective map to V dual, and the kernel of this map will be six-dimensional. So let me denote it by V perp. So this is just the kernel of this map. And this is, because of this codimension condition, this is six-dimensional vector space. And now let us consider the projectivization of this space lambda 2 W dual, and it's the projectivization of this linear subspace in it, P of V perp. And note that in this big projective space, there is a natural cubic hypersurface. So basically, this space parametrizes skew forms on a six-dimensional space, and we can consider just all degenerate skew forms. For a skew form, the condition to be degenerate is controlled by the determinant of this skew form. And since the dimension of the space W is even, the determinant of a skew form on this space is equal to the square of the Pfaffian of this form. And since the determinant of a 6x6 matrix is a polynomial of degree 6 in its elements, the Pfaffian, which is the square root of this determinant, is a polynomial of degree 3. So its vanishing gives you a hypersurface of degree 3, which is usually called the Pfaffian hypersurface. So this is the Pfaffian cubic hypersurface in this projective space. And then you can define X to be, again, the intersection. So it will be the intersection of this cubic hypersurface with this P5 space. And of course, it will be a cubic fourfold. And then one can check that one has this equivalence. So this is an example when something like that holds. And in fact, there are also some other examples when such an equivalence can be constructed. But in general, the general picture, which is not yet proved, but again, which we expect, is the following. So let us consider the moduli space of all cubic fourfolds. Let me call it just M for simplicity. This is a certain moduli space of dimension 20. So it's easy to see that the dimension of this moduli space is 20. Just if you consider what is the data you have to specify a cubic fourfold, you need to specify a polynomial of degree 3 of 6 variables, and the space of these polynomials has dimension 56. But also we have a GL6 group acting on the space. So the quotient of the space of all polynomials by this action of the group, it gives you this moduli space, and its dimension is 56 minus 36, which is 20. So we have this 20-dimensional moduli space. And what we expect is that there should be countably many divisors say d sub d are parameterized by some integers in this moduli space such that for any x, for any cubic fourfold that corresponds to a point of this divisor, there is a K3 surface which is a polarized K3 surface of degree D, so it corresponds to a point of a moduli space of polarized K3 surfaces of this degree. Such that the corresponding categories, AX is equivalent to D of Y. And the case that was described here corresponds to polarization of degree 14. And in some sense, in fact, this is the smallest value of D for which such situation is expected. The next case should be D equal to 26 that was described recently by Nick Addington and his co-authors. So next case. So the case D equal to 14 is well understood, and it is on this blackboard. So the next case is D equal to 26, and was done by Addington and his co-authors. And the next case is D equal to 38, in which case we don't have a description yet. So, so you see that, in fact, for many cubic fourfolds, we expect this category to be, in fact, commutative, but in fact, it is very easy to see that for a general cubic fourfold, this category is not commutative. So for general, x, in fact, ax is not equivalent to d of y for any k3. In fact, for any algebraic variety. And this is one of the conjectures that a cubic fourfold is rational if and only if this holds, if there is a K3 surface equivalent, derived equivalent to this category. So let me mention, since this was asked, so this is a conjecture that X is rational, that this category controls rationality. And only if AX is equivalent to D of Y. For a general, for some commutative K3 surface Y. Let me maybe mention that this result, in fact, is very simple. You can just see how the numerical Grothendieck group of this category looks. And it is easy to check that for a general cubic fourfold, its numerical Grothendieck group has rank 2, while for any K3 surface, it has rank at least 3, because there is this is clear. So for a general cubic fourfold, we cannot have anything of this sort. So this observation shows that this conjecture would imply non-rationality of a general cubic fourfold, which is a very old conjecture, which we can't prove yet. Okay, and also probably I should have said before that, of course, you could ask in this direction, maybe we can somehow also decompose this category. Maybe this decomposition is not good enough. Maybe we can find some semi-orthogonal decomposition for this piece of this category and get a more precise information. But in fact, from this property, we see that AX is a Calabi-Yau category. And so, in fact, the Bridgeland argument shows that this category is indecomposable. Or maybe let me mention it here. Decomposable. And since it is indecomposable, if this category would be equivalent to the derived category of any algebraic variety, then it follows that the variety should be a surface with zero canonical class. And from this, it follows that it should be a K3 surface. And then you see that for a general X, this does not hold. Okay, so this is a short summary about this category. Now let me say a couple of words about geometric implications of this for moduli spaces. So what do we have about geometry? Of course, since the essential piece of this category is a K3 category, we should expect that the moduli spaces behave like moduli spaces of sheaves on a K3 surface. And one of the nicest observations about moduli spaces of K3 surface is that all of them carry a symplectic form. So we should expect to have maybe not symplectic, but maybe a two form on any moduli space on a K3 surface. And indeed, this is what happens. So if for any moduli space of sheaves on X, on a cubic fourfold, there is a natural holomorphic two form on it. And again, the picture you should have in mind here is the following. So we have this semi-orthogonal decomposition. So let me maybe denote by alpha the embedding functor from this component to D of X. Then we can consider the corresponding projection functor, say alpha star from D of X to AX. And so, as we discussed, it induces maybe a rational morphism from some moduli space of sheaves on X. Yes, so we can specify some rank, C1, C2, and so on. We can consider some moduli space of sheaves on X, and there will be a morphism to some modular space of objects in this category. And this modular space, in fact, should carry a symplectic to form. And in fact, one can check that the kernel spaces of this holomorphic two-form constructed on this modular space, they just correspond to tangent spaces to the fibers of this morphism. So tangent spaces. Two fibers are the kernel spaces for the two form of this theorem. And so, in fact, this symplectic two form on this modular space can be thought of as a form induced by this two form and this projection. And again, so maybe let me give some examples to see a bit better what happens here. So maybe the most well-known example of this sort is if you consider again the Hilbert scheme of lines for this cubic fourfold. So if you consider the Hilbert scheme of lines of X, this is just an example of a modular space, then in fact, if you consider this projection functor, it induces an isomorphism to some modular space of objects in this category AX. And in particular, the two form that can be constructed on this Hilbert scheme of lines is itself symplectic. So this carries a symplectic form. And in particular, since this is a smooth projective variety with a holomorphic symplectic form, it follows that it is hyperkähler, in fact. And this was first observed by Bavil and Danagi. So this is a very interesting hyperkähler variety of dimension 4. So now one can ask what happens for curves of bigger degree. So the next case one can consider is the Hilbert scheme of conics. In fact, in this case, the map to the modular space is not an isomorphism, but in fact, it can be thought of, it factorizes through a natural map to the Hilbert scheme of lines, which, as we have seen, can be considered as the modular space of objects in this category. And in fact, this map is very easy to describe geometrically. So if you have a conic on a, so if we have this cubic fourfold, and if we have a conic on it, then every conic generates a projective plane. Yeah, so we can consider the projective plane in the ambient P5, which is just the linear hull of this conic. And then we can intersect this plane with this cubic hypersurface. Of course, the intersection contains a conic, so but the intersection should be a curve of degree 3. It means that it should decompose as a union of this conic and the line. And so in this way, we can associate with every conic on X a certain line. Of course, there is a subtle point here that this plane can be contained in the cubic fourfold, and in this case, this this map will not be defined at these particular conics. So in general, this map is not regular but only rational, and this is just an example that such a projection is not regular in general. But I mean, for instance, we can restrict to considering only cubic fourfolds that do not contain planes. a general cubic four-plot has this property, so then this map will be regular. And in fact, this map, I mean, let us pretend that it is regular, maybe by considering sufficiently general cubic four-folds, then in fact this map is a P3 vibration, and these fibers, these P3, they just correspond to different planes passing through a given line, and the tangent spaces to the fibers are precisely the kernel spaces of the two form on this Hilbert scheme of conics. So this is the second example. Maybe let me mention two more examples because they are also quite interesting. So first of all, one can consider next case, which is the Hilbert scheme of twisted cubic curves. Maybe I should say rational cubic curves in X. And then it turns out that this is a nice 10-dimensional variety. This is a nice smooth 10-dimensional variety, again, for a sufficiently general X. But the two form on this variety is not symplectic. It is degenerate. In fact, its core rank in a general point equals 2. So from this picture, we expect a vibration with two-dimensional fibers. And in fact, one can see, one can check that there is a picture like that. So there is maybe, let me write M prime of AX to distinguish from that moduli space. And here M prime AX tilde. And this map is a P2 vibration here and a blow up here. This is a recent result by Christoph Lehn, Manfred Lehn, Christoph Zörger, and Duca van Straten. So, and this moduli space that they construct as a contraction of this Hilbert scheme of rational cubic curves is in fact a nice 8-dimensional hyperkähler variety. And there is one more interesting hyperkähler variety recently constructed for a cubic fourfold in a similar fashion. This was done in a recent paper by Radu Laza, Julius Sakka, and Claire Voisin. In fact, they proved that there is the following nice hyperkähler variety. So if you consider a cubic fourfold, you can also consider its hyperplane section. So let me denote it by XH, which is a cubic threefold, of course. And then one can consider a certain special moduli space of shapes on it that is isomorphic to its intermediate Jacobian. In fact, for a cubic threefold, you can realize its intermediate Jacobian as a certain moduli space of shapes. I guess that this is not true in general, but this is true in this case. And so one can consider the moduli space, in this way, we have a five-dimensional space of cubic threefolds sitting inside this given cubic fourfold, just all hyperplane sections. And for each of them, we have its five-dimensional intermediate Jacobian. So we can consider, so to say, universal intermediate Jacobian of all hyperplane sections. This will be a variety which will map to the space of all hyperplanes in our projective space, with fiber being the intermediate Jacobian of the corresponding hyperplane section. And they showed that this 10-dimensional variety is also hyperkähler. And in fact, this is a very interesting hyperkähler variety. I mean, in the previous two examples, the corresponding hyperkähler varieties were deformation equivalent to Hilbert squares of K3 surfaces. But this one, I mean, here to the Hilbert square and here to the Hilp 4 of K3, but this one is not a deformation equivalent to Hilp 5 of K3. In fact, it is a deformation equivalent to one of two sporadic O'Grady hyperkähler for varieties. So you see that you can find very interesting geometric information which follows in some sense from this K3 property of this category. And I wouldn't be surprised very much if some other moduli spaces of sheaves on a cubic fourfold will give in the end some new examples of hyperkähler varieties. I think this is a very interesting direction of research. Okay, so yeah, I guess that I don't have much more to say, and my time is over. So maybe I should also say that there are some other very interesting higher dimensional varieties that behave in a very similar way. So there are other examples of varieties whose derived category is generated by some exceptional collection plus a K3 category. And also one can investigate moduli spaces of these varieties and try to find some hyperkähler structures on them. So, I mean, maybe one should somehow summarize the point of my lectures as saying that if you know or if you can guess how the derived category of your variety looks like, it gives you a lot of evidence about how moduli spaces of objects on this variety should, what kind of properties they should have just from the structure of the derived category. And this this is very useful if you want really to describe these moduli spaces or if you are searching for some interesting example. This is like, I mean, derived categories should give you some light in the dark forest of moduli spaces. Let me stop here.